be great. So feedback is a campaigning organisation that really does a lot of research and raises awareness about improvements to the food system. So do check us out at feedbackglobal.org if you'd like to see any of our sort of work and see what we're working on sort of campaign wise. And feedback is funded by the Rothschild Foundation in Buckinghamshire to run the Food Citizens Project. And that's really raising awareness about reducing food waste and seeing how we can obviously make our diets a little bit more sustainable as well. So welcome to Buck's Food Revolution, which is a weekend of many different events with many different experts, professionals and local enthusiasts sharing some of their projects, some of their sort of voluntary work, as well as their hobbies, really to inspire us all to have a look at food, the food that we eat, the food that we waste, and really seeing how we can improve for the future of the planet and the future of our generations. So without further ado, I would like to introduce you to Justine, who is on the call. Are you there, Justine? Is she there?
Mute. Here I am. Can you see me? Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
There we go. Okay.
Lovely.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I'm just trying. Yes, we've got you.
Hang on 2 seconds. So I was just going to quickly say something about Grow to Give, and then we're going to show you a video. And then Sheila's going to come in at the end, Sheila Bees, to tell you how High Wycombe have been involved as well in Grow to Give and a few plans for the future. So, sorry. Obviously, it's been a really, really strange year. And back in March, when the pandemic hit, I knew there'd be economic fallout from the pandemic. And I wanted to think about how I could help. And I was growing food at the time. And I thought I'd just grow a bit more. And if we all just grew a bit more and donated that food, we could have a real impact, sort of a community garden across thousands of different bits of land and allotment sites. And really just been so blown away about what's happened this year. And it set us up to think we really want to do more next year as well. So I had a background in community projects, and I knew I didn't have the skills to sew scrubs or be frontline in the NHS. I'm not brave enough for that, but it's just been really remarkable how all these growers have come together, and really at a time when we all need to come together, it's provided a really healthy, safe way to give back to people at a real time of need. So I've got a video that we've put together. And as I say, we've got Sheila will tell us a bit later on, and there's a little bit of opportunity for questions after that.
My name's Adam Townsend, and I run the storehouse, Elderbury Vineyard Storehouse Food Bank. We've obviously seen a huge demand, and with the dry goods that we normally hand out, there hasn't been enough when we first hit COVID. So having the extra fresh stuff to bulk out the food parcels and to is really great. And I mean, I think the other issue that we've always had is making sure that our clients are trying to eat healthier as well. So the fresh produce just seems to tick all the boxes for us.
Are we going in the side, Chris, or in the back?
Yeah, I'm going to go around the
end. Yeah.
Around
the back?
Around the end there.
What do you see generally in terms of health needs?
So, I mean, generally, anyone who is suffering in some way in poverty usually has bad health associated with that as well. So any extra healthy food is good for them, definitely.
It just provides more support to help them out of their situation at that time.
And, you know, not all of them will take the fresh, so we do ask them whether they know what it is, if they are able to cook with it. And I mean, some of the produce that's come through, we've had struggled to identify because we're not gardeners.
So some of the more unusual donations.
Yes, but we've got a couple of clients that really look forward to having the rhubarb through. The marrows, we had tons of marrows donated. And we were having to give out recipes to the clients and tell them what they had to do with them. But we managed to get rid of all of the marrows, and I don't think we had to throw any away, which was fantastic. Great.
And your chef on site, because you also make meals here, don't
we
you?
Do.
So did they use the marrows as well?
Yeah, we used the marrows for bases for curries, just endless recipes that I didn't know even existed to use marrows for.
Everything.
And then all the fresh herbs, the chef was over the moon, and she kind of hangs around waiting for the van to come back with all the fresh produce now, so she gets first pick for the kitchen.
And what are some of the reactions you've had from the food bank clients with the fresh food? What have been some of the notable things that you remember from?
I think, looking back, when we first started doing it, it was a sense of community and help and everyone pulling together for this pandemic. And then secondly, it actually inspired a lot of our clients. So there was one of our clients, and she actually had an allotment but hadn't been using it. So it inspired her to go back. So she's now actually growing her own veg again.
Oh, that's great.
And she sends pictures every now and then, or messages to say how she's getting on.
Oh, so that's fantastic to hear. And then not all food banks obviously take fresh food.
No.
And you know, there are sets of different things that you need to consider. Well, how difficult do you think it is to deal with fresh food as a food bank manager?
It is harder, obviously, the food hygiene side of things. So all of our volunteers, we have to do basic food hygiene training with, and then we've got some of the staff have got higher levels of food hygiene. We will then need fridges to keep stuff in, freezers. So it is slightly harder, but I think the benefits definitely outweigh that.
Just when you invest in a bit of the infrastructure, then.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you weigh everything in here as well,
we do,
don't you?
So. Which is a massive chore, but it's really good. So, I mean, obviously, we send through the figures to you, so we know how much the produce. And then recently we've done the harvest festivals for the school, local churches.
It's a real motivator, I think, to the people that are donating. And I know the people at the allotments, when they've known how much is coming through, it's really, really helped them.
It is, it is good.
But that's fantastic. Thank you so much for everything you do here.
Thank you.
Susanna, so tell me what's involved in your coordinator role.
Well, it's not onerous at all. On a Sunday night, all the allotmenteers at the various allotments donate their produce, put it in crates, and then I bring the crate from my own allotment over to the one where it's collected from on the Monday morning. And obviously at this time of year when it's darker, the cut-off time is earlier, but in the summer it's quite late, you know, before dusk, and it all gets protected from animals or anybody else really overnight. And then, as I say, it's collected by the charity that we're donating it to on the first thing on a Monday morning, and they know where they can come and collect it. And as I said earlier, we've apparently donated over a ton of vegetables and fruit this summer, which has been absolutely amazing.
Yeah, amazing.
We take
amazing.
Photographs. Actually, another thing, we take photographs of it every week so we can see what we've donated, and also it's weighed when it arrives at the charity, so that's how we've been able to come to this figure of a ton of veg.
And we've been able to tell people a bit, haven't we, every few weeks, what total we're up to, and I think that's helped people get an idea.
Motivating.
Helped to get an idea, but never did we think we'd be able to get a ton, I don't think, from just a couple of allotments working together.
And we're reassured that actually all of that's been used. It's really easy to have gluts of things, as everybody knows who's had a million courgettes at any one time of the summer. And I think that, you know, there's a lot of things that jeopardise your things on your allotment, you know, pests and animals and the weather and lack of water, all sorts of things. And so you tend to overgrow in the hope that you'll actually get what you want. And so it's very easy to have an excess. And this is just a brilliant way of donating one's excess to a good cause. Because often when you've got excess, other people have got excess too. And so you can't give it to friends or other allotmenteers. And so this charity is the ideal way of using up excess fruit and veg, which might otherwise go to waste.
That's great. And what kind of produce have you been able to donate this year yourself?
Well, today I've got some squash, and I've got a patty pan squash and some beetroot. And
that's lovely.
It varies from week to week, obviously, as the season goes on. But I think courgettes are probably the thing that we saw most of this summer. Yeah. Everybody always has lots of courgettes. And in fact, I'm a book publisher, and I'm about to publish a book called 50 Things to Do with Courgettes.
Oh, really? Oh, that'll interest
because it is
feedback.
Such a problem. My mum was a keen gardener. My granddad was a keen gardener. He actually had a cafe, and he used to grow all his own vegetables for his cafe.
Oh, wow.
And so I think it's just in my genes. So I've always been keen on both veg and flower gardening. I actually have a very small garden in the grounds of my passive house, which I built 2 years ago. And so I took on allotments because there just wasn't any potential to grow vegetables in my own garden. And so I suppose I'm quite, you know, I really like the idea of, you know, eating what I've grown, what I know has gone into it. You know, when you buy things from the shops, you actually never know quite what's been applied to the growing of the produce. And when you grow it yourself, you know exactly what's gone onto it. And so it feels healthier, it feels more ecologically sound, you know, it's grown on your doorstep, there's no air miles involved, in my case about a quarter of a mile. Everyone with allotments could adopt the same principle and the same scheme in their own locality. That would be fantastic.
And you're my neighbour at one of our allotments, and you've kindly just given me a whole load of raspberry canes. And I think it's that type of thing, like sharing between people to try and make the food go further and enable people to be able to grow cheaply.
Basic gardeners are actually quite they're close to the earth, and I think they're quite generous spirited people. Yeah. And I think that that's a sharing proposition is something that sort of just most normal gardeners feel naturally. You know, you have excess, you give it away. You know, you have seedlings, you give them away. You know, it's just an obvious thing to do, really. Yeah. Particularly on allotments where you have neighbours that aren't just house neighbours, they're actually literally gardening neighbours, and they're right, you know, hugger mugger with you. So it's very easy to ask and donate and ask for favours or give favours or whatever.
And what's unusual, I think, for Grow to Give this time is that there's been three allotments really working together in this town, and perhaps you haven't had a chance perhaps to work together on something before. So that's obviously introduced you to new people, and you've come up today with some of your produce from your allotment. Shall we have a look what's in the baskets and you can put it in and
We've got some lovely parsnips. We've got a very knobbly parsnip here. A kitty would love that, make a good joke of that one. And then we've got some pumpkins and some leeks.
Some leftover from Halloween.
Some kale and some cooking apples, which has been a massive glut this year because we had no frost at the crucial time this year.
Really?
So the,
it's a good
all
year.
The hard fruits has been fantastic year, pears and apples. So later this morning, this will all go off to the vineyard and hopefully be made into some really interesting dishes.
To think that it goes to a good cause and people who might appreciate it.
Every week we get a big crate from you, don't we? Almost, it feels like.
Well, it has to be seasonal produce. The Italian kale, obviously, very, very useful.
Lovely.
Apples, I don't know what they are, they're probably all eaters. And obviously the celery this time of year, might be past salad time, so we'll use those in soup.
Lovely.
And those look like potatoes. They might be pink fir apple or something similar. Might be annual pink fir apple. I suppose you start with perhaps a few peas, you move on to summer cabbage. Hopefully we keep it going as long as possible.
And John, you're one of the best growers on here, aren't you? So we've
I think you're being modest.
So we do thank you very much for everything you've given to Grow to Give this season. So thanks.
Specifically what's been happening in Wickham and a few plans for 2021.
And you can chip in as well. So hello, I have my own allotment and I run a community allotment with in Grow Together with Richard Andrews, and we're at Back Lane in High Wickham, and we had the similar idea to Justine that we all have loads of gluts of vegetables and that I would try and marshal this spare produce and be able to give it to the food bank at One Can Trust in High Wickham. So I made a bid to Feedback Global and the funding was successful. Thank you, Feedback Global. And we used a lot of our funding to build these sustainable donation boxes. So they're all made of wood, no plastic, and they should last for many years. And there's Jeff who designed them and built them. And we had volunteers to help him build the other four after he'd done the pilot one. So next slide, we then did the big sell to try and get our five allotments on board. And we managed to get Back Lane, Desborough Castle, Green Hill, Queensway and Ashley Drive on board. And because they're so spread out around Wickham, there was no way that I could run around them all picking up all the produce. So I managed to get one or sometimes two champions on each site to promote the project and to agree what day they were going to donate the vegetables to the food bank. So it took a bit of learning. It wasn't plain sailing and things would be put in the box and I'd get a complaint no one had collected it because they hadn't noticed the collection day was different to the day they were putting it in. But eventually it streamlined and we slowly began to get the produce going on the right day, so it was nice and fresh. We started off later than Justine, but we managed to collect over 400 kilograms of fresh food later, you know, get to be donated to the food bank. Feedback told us about Justine, and we forged a friendship through COVID rules, we seemed to manage, and decided to pool our resources and work together. And I loved the name Grow to Give, so asked Justine if we could just join in and call ourselves Grow to Give, and be part of the same scheme. Following on from that, Justine has worked so hard in the last few months and obtained funding from Bucks Council for the two allotments she's already working with, plus three new ones for Aylesbury, as well as three allotments in Wickham to be added to the scheme. So what we're hoping is, I'm focusing on Woburn Green and Bourne End, Flackwell Heath and Hughenden Parish Council, because they've got eight sites with 250 plots on. So if we can't get a lot of vegetables out of that site, I'm not trying very hard, am I? So if anybody knows allotment gardeners on any of those three sites, come my way, please, and we'll see if we can start getting attention with the growers in those three sites. So what were we getting for the project agreement with Public Health Bucks Council? So the idea was to aim to reduce food waste by donating 250 kilograms of fresh produce between all the sites.
So Sheila, it's 2.5 tons.
Sorry, 2,500 kilograms. What did I say? 250, thank you. But it's about building a sustainable infrastructure. And this was born out of COVID's crisis, to actually get people to know what they can do with all their spare produce, rather than sadly try and press more runner beans on friends that are closing their curtains as you walk up the drive with more spare produce. It also will involve over 100 local volunteers, I'm sure we'll get involved, and provide them with a fun and safe way to help others. We always get a feel-good factor from helping other people, and this is one way we can facilitate that with Grow to Give. We'll also be developing 20 seasonal recipe cards to complement the donations as the seasons progress, and to be able to go into the food boxes that go out from the food banks. And then it's important to develop a community of eco-friendly growers. If anybody watched the David Attenborough film about how to save the world, it sounds pretentious, but it really is the challenge that we have. And we need to help our growers to be caring for the environment and reducing the amount of chemicals and pesticides that they use in their growing. So we're going to do 7 video streamed masterclasses. One will be on composting and 2 on growing well. Then the other 4 will be on cooking your harvest. But essential to this is this online support group. So we're hoping to share best practice, and that will be complemented with the website and Facebook page with how-to information for growers to dip into. I'm doing an allotment event at 6 o'clock today, trying to get allotment growers to talk about their successes. So maybe that will be something that people like, and we continue as part of this project as well. So Justine, is there anything else you want to add?
No, that's great, Sheila. You've covered everything. Just to say that obviously we're looking at as many ways as possible we can support the food bank clients. So we're looking at recipe card ideas with simple 5 ingredient recipes that our fresh food can support, almost like a HelloFresh or Gusto, that you get your fresh ingredients, your dried ingredients, your recipe card, and a bit of support online from online nutrition cookery classes as well. So hopefully it'll be involving both growers and receivers of the food as well. I think that's it.
So does anyone have any questions for Justine and Sheila? I don't know if anything came up.
No.
Okay.
Looks like we've got Susan. Hello.
Yeah, hello.
Susan,
if you'd like...
and then Hannah.
Okay.
Hi, sorry, is it me?
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry, my Wi-Fi is having a bit of a wobble this morning. Hi, everybody. Hi.
Hi.
I just wanted to ask, Sheila, something you just said there about growers and receivers. Is there any plan to get the receivers involved in the growing?
No, but it's a lovely idea. I mean, we really would welcome it at our community allotments. And I'm sure Shanti, who's going to talk later, I mean, there are various versions of community allotments. People get a lot out of coming to the community allotment. And we have a mental health recovery group that come to ours. And even if they just come and sit in the green space or sit by the river, which runs through our allotment, they get a very good feel-good factor. And you'll find them just lying on the soil sometimes because they say they want to lie on the soil, whatever makes them feel good, you know. But there is something special about working on a community allotment, working with others, and just learning a few skills on the way and taking your spinach home with you that you've helped to grow. So yes, we would welcome more.
We've had some initial conversations with people about it. I think for this next year, we're just going to try and like build our infrastructure. And then after that, like, we're up for collaborations wherever it makes sense.
Mm.
And obviously we've talked about giving people seed packs out from the food banks as well, or herb pots or things like that, that will make their cooking easier. So I think that is definitely empowering people to be able to grow their own food rather than receive it is obviously a really good idea. But at the moment, this next year, we're just doing the infrastructure. But we might be able to do a bit more. Anything else?
Hannah, is it a question?
Yeah, Hannah.
Hello, Hannah from Sustain. Yeah, it's such a great scheme. It's just brilliant. It's genius. How easy was it to get people interested in helping? I'm just thinking, what would it take for all allotments in Bucks to have a scheme like this? There are about 130 of them, I think.
It all depends on the allotment. I mean, the ones here in Wendover have been incredibly easy to get involved. And, you know, almost one allotment, almost on its own, it has been help from another one, has pretty much done the 1,000 kilos, which is incredible. But they've just all really got behind it. It's part of that culture. They're a very sociable allotment anyway. I just think it depends on who takes it on board. Mm. And, you know, it takes quite a lot of, I've done a lot with that allotment because it's my local allotment as well, to just make, you know, go and help, incentivize with communication. We have plans this year to buy some seeds and hopefully get some given to us as well, to give out seeds, to say, you know, I mean, it's a bit of a cheap trick, but here's some grow to give seeds, grow some and give us some of the produce from it kind of thing. But everybody likes a freebie. So I think it's just tapping into people. And once they start to see how much the food bank's appreciating it, it kind of just all snowballs. And now, like, I'm literally, I think this is the last collection tonight we're doing in the one here. And they're all really sad about that. So they want to do dry goods over Christmas and some dry good collections. So it's almost like you can't, I don't want to stop them, but you know, they've definitely got the momentum going. It's a sustainable thing now that is happening.
I think in Wickham, I haven't got the same connection with the allotment. I have the champions out there and I will next year spend a lot more time supporting the champions to get out and make those connections with the tenants. Because some of the sites are really quite big. And if you always go on a Sunday, you don't see the Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday people that are popping in. So it will take a lot more time and effort, which we will put in now, to try and get everybody else knowing about what's going on their own allotment.
Well, the funding helps, doesn't it?
Yes, absolutely.
Because before it was obviously all what we could just do really quickly and from a volunteer perspective with the feedback funding as well. But I mean, things like hopefully we'll actually be able to see people at some point next year and maybe have little events on the allotments. But I tend to like to walk around the allotments and talk to people about it as well. And like the lady said on the video, I think gardeners are generally very sharing, giving people. So it's not that difficult. Once you get going.
Okay, lovely. All right, and thank you very much. If there are any other questions, I can see there are some coming in, then obviously we'll be taking questions at the end as well. So you'll be able to ask any other burning questions then. Next we have a video from Linden Gate, which is a mental health charity in Amesbury. So some of you may have heard of it before. We unfortunately couldn't have someone from Linden Gate with us today. So we actually have their video to play for you. If you do have issues with the sound, do let me know. May be quiet again.
Linden Gate is a site-based new resource space in Buckinghamshire, which has been set up to help people with mental health needs. And we do a thing called social and therapeutic horticulture. But our mission statement is to foster an improved state of mental health and well-being through the healing nature of gardening and horticulture. It started up as a passionate grain of an idea between myself, my name's Charlie Powell, and a very good friend of mine called Sean Shackle, who for differing reasons wanted to provide a facility based on social and therapeutic horticulture, which we knew worked. And we specifically, as I say, wanted to do it for people with mental health needs, because within our area there are very few people doing that. And it has been scientifically proven that social and therapeutic horticulture really does help people with mental health needs. It takes three aspects, really. It takes the fact that we are inherently and genetically receptive to green spaces.
How is that for people? Is that okay, sound wise?
It's low, but I can hear it.
It might be clearer if you try and share audio, share computer audio as well. So if at the top where you see that green bar,
yep.
I think you should be able to click view options and then share computer audio.
Which option, sorry?
View options, and then there's a drop-down menu.
I don't have the option.
If you click on the green...
Okay.
Itself.
Yeah, I don't think. Yeah, I don't think I can do that.
Okay.
I mean, do you want me to keep playing it, or shall I? Yeah.
Yeah, I can hear it. It's just a bit fuzzy, but it is audible.
Okay.
Through the healing nature of gardening and horticulture. It started up as a passionate grain of an idea between myself, my name's Charlie Powell, and a very good friend of mine called Sean Shackle, who for differing reasons wanted to provide a facility based on social and therapeutic horticulture, which we knew worked. And we specifically, as I say, wanted to do it for people with mental health needs, because within our area, there are very few people doing that, and it has been scientifically proven that social and therapeutic horticulture really does help people with mental health needs. It takes three aspects, really. It takes the fact that we are inherently and genetically receptive to green spaces. So the outdoors generally, if you see a green space, historically that was food, water, shelter, and all the things that you needed to survive. So everybody, whether they realise it or not, needs to spend a certain amount of time outside in green spaces. The second one is that we also need community. We need to be engaging with other people. And here at Bloomgate, we're passionate about developing what is already a very good community into a fantastic community of people where you feel valued and you feel as if you belong to something very special. And the third thing is that we all need to have purpose in our life. We all need to have activities that we can engage with, which get us from A to B, and we can feel a sense of achievement. And social and political culture in a managed and measurable setup with outcomes deals with providing people those three things. Bloomgate has lots of ways in which people can help. You don't have to be a gardener, you don't have to have green fingers, because there's an awful lot of aspects of what is a 5-acre, very active site and a very growing site for people to volunteer their time, their skills, and their energy and their enthusiasm. That we need people with landscape gardening skills, fundraising skills, even just starting to make teas and coffees, admin skills, marketing, PR, all those sorts of things. Almost anybody, given any amount of time, can support and help them again. And of course, if you really can't do that, we need money, as with all of these sorts of charities. Whilst we charge for people to come along, because that again is part of the process of people valuing what we're doing, and it helps us to be sustainable. And we are continuously going to be in need of additional funding, partly to develop the site that we have, because we've got all sorts of ideas for what we can do with it, but also because there are an awful lot of people out there who need our support with mental health needs, and because of the way the system works, there's a big hole where they don't get any support from the government through the NHS or through benefits or anything like that. So we're also looking to set up bursaries so that those people can come to us and benefit from what we're doing, because we know that if we can catch them early, we can save the NHS loads of money.
I was made redundant and I had the opportunity to kind of look for a different direction. And I thought I'd just continue on what I was doing and look something different. So I had a bit of time to think, and I thought that I love the outdoors, I love nature, and I've been asked to work a bit more with people. And we came across the notion of social and therapeutic horticulture and investigated a bit more, and decided it was something that I'd love to do, and just did a little research on Google and found you guys on the internet in Richmond, see if I can answer.
Personally, I have lots of future aspirations for Bloomgate, which involve all sorts of exciting projects. What we can do out there, we want to have a big pond, we want to have a big cottage garden, we want to do things like stumperies, and oh, you name it. I mean, there are no real restrictions on what we can try horticulturally. But I think on the other side of the coin, and perhaps more important, is we want to be able to help as many people as possible with mental health needs.
I think there are probably a few things that make it different. One is the lovely community feel. It has a very nice feel because everyone's equal. Everyone comes through the door, leaves their diagnosis at the gate, and lovely atmosphere, so it's not the place to come. The size of the plot makes it unique. Within 5 acres, there's so much space, you can do so many things. We can do gardening and gardening related craft activities, and also cooking. We will set up to do cooking activities as well. So we can follow the whole journey through from growing something to cooking, which is really nice as well.
We also want to provide them with skills and develop an educational program and work with local businesses and national businesses so that we can make sure that people actually have somewhere to go moving on from here. A bit like a bridge and a stepping stone out and back into normal life.
I haven't got sound to it, I don't think.
No, we don't have sounds.
Okay. lovely.
Okay. I'm ready to answer any questions regarding our organization, what are we doing and what's the purpose of the organization. And of course, my co-director Arunta also joining with me, if any sense, if you want, she's a creative director of the organization. So we are open to discussion if we, according to the time factor.
Susie's got a question.
Yes. Yeah, Shanti, that looks amazing. How did you get started?
Which one?
So who woke up one morning and said, I know we're going to have a community fridge, and then what was the next step?
I will talk about the community fridge. So community fridge, we started in December 2017. It was the 49th one in the country. And Rothschild for Hubbub is the organization. They innovated that concept as a community fridge. It was growing, and we managed to hold that 49th community fridge in the High Wycombe in Buckinghamshire. So within the Buckinghamshire, we have a High Wycombe community fridge, Aylesbury community fridge, and a Chesham community fridge. So as an organization.
Okay, so you heard about the idea somewhere else. Yeah.
We got the information directly from, of course, it's a Googling, and other thing is we got the information from Community Impact Bucks.
Mm-hmm.
So they were, you know, they are, we sign up with the newsletters, we got the information, and we sign up with them. And we had been in a competition with the other organization, and Hubbub selected us because of our practice and the ethos, and we were successful to hold that community fridge in our Buckingham High Wycombe.
Mm-hmm.
So 2017, in December the 10th, we are going to open up. Now we are stepping into the third year. So every year we are decided to do different things. Of course, it's initiatives. And this year we are going to do Christmas box initiatives. Mm-hmm. So we are planning to give 100 boxes to our old guests in partnership with, of course, we don't have a premises in our own organization. We have a community fridge site. It is based in Oakridge Baptist Church in Green Street. So we are having a partnership with the church, of course. And the church is supporting us to collect some food, and our guests are donating and all over the network collecting food. And we are planning to organize over 100 Christmas boxes. So that's how we open up. But it's a concept came to our mind. It's just because of one day I watched the documentary movie in a Channel 4. They talk about the food waste, especially in Spain and Germany. It was a documentary program. So that's the concept came to how did they use the waste food and so on. Then I did the Google research, of course, that's research. Then came to the picture Hubbub and the Sustain, all the organization care. Then finally, now we are in here. So recently, in the last month, we marked the 100th community fridge in the UK. So we are basically going through the, there are two concepts belongs to this community fridge. First one is the excess food redistribution. In terms of other way around is waste food. Otherwise, those food will go to the landfill. We want to stop that part. So secondly, we want to reduce the gap between, let's say, stigmatizing the people to get access food. So that part we don't have. That's why we called our users as a guest. So guests are coming to home, let's say my home, guests are coming, I'm treat them in the very best level. So that's the way we want to treat our guests. So we give the best thing, best quality food, and which is supposed to go to landfill, and a guest will consume. So both parties are happy. And that's the whole way we are dealing. It's a strategy is stigmatizing people, and carbon emission. We want to reduce all the things and be with the society and play your role. That's the whole concept. We are not addressing hunger or food poverty or nothing as that. So yeah, we are just different concept, and that's the thing we are implementing. We are proud to do so.
You should be. It's wonderful. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Move things to the end questions. Is that okay? And we just have the next
question. That's fine. Brilliant. No problem.
Fabulous. All right. So I'm going to introduce Carl next, if he's there ready to talk.
Yes, I'm ready.
Cool.
Okay. Are you ready for me now?
Yep, go for it.
I'm going to ask you to put on slide one while I'm talking. Okay. So welcome, everyone. Welcome to Grow It, Cook It and Share It. I'll say a little bit about me. My name is Carl Gale, and I'm a director at Community Youth Ventures. I've worked in youth work, education, criminal justice and community development within the last 25 years. I'm also a keen gardener in my spare time, and I feel passionate about bringing youth work and horticulture together. We set up Community Youth Ventures, a community interest company, as we wanted to inspire young people through innovative and diversionary activities. Our aim is to empower young people to make positive choices, enhance their opportunities and widen their horizons in and around their communities. We also provide strategic oversight and expertise, as well as direct youth engagement through a range of youth programs and projects. Our key partners are the police, social care, schools and the Youth Offending Service. Next slide, please. So, how we got here. One of the main drivers for wanting to set up a community allotment is due to the surge in mental health and obesity issues and illnesses amongst young people, and the lack of green spaces for families to enjoy. We hope this service can fill this need and offer an alternative way of learning that can enhance young people's development, especially in these testing times. Slide three, please. So our community spot. So this is our allotment in Bedgrove when we first took it over. I think it was just after COVID or during COVID times. It's a lovely spot behind security gates, giving it a sense of privacy and community. It's a fairly large plot and perfect for us at the present time. Eventually, we do hope to take on other allotments plots in Chesham and High Wycombe. Next slide, please. Our vision. So our vision is for all young people to learn how to grow, harvest and cook their own produce. We will also offer cooking lessons, independent living skills and healthy living activities within our sessions. This is what allotment looks like after a bit of sweat and tears. Still loads to do, however, the foundations have been completed and we are now ready to offer young people a safe place to go and have fun. Next slide, please. The benefits. There are so many benefits, as you can see, which are listed. However, for me, the ones I hold dear to my heart are young people having opportunities they would not normally have access to, and young people enjoying the outdoors and getting fresh air whilst learning a new skill. Next slide, please. So here are all the benefits. And I think to make the organisation sustainable, I'm just going to read them off. So we intend to use our produce for all our cooking sessions. We intend to promote the healthy eating agenda, five every day. Provide veg bags for parents and also for schools. So, parents can pick up their children at school and grab a grow bag or grab a, box of vegetables. We also want to deal with obesity issues, by indirectly teaching young people and families the importance of growing their own and having a good diet. And obviously for the environment, growing locally will cut food miles, which will reduce the carbon footprint, which is something I learned off Becca, so thank you. All right, next slide, please. Okay, so skills for young people. Our programme will enable young people to have access to a qualified youth worker whilst on the project, offering support and guidance and learning skills that they can take long into adulthood. All of our teaching is informal and focused on young people's strengths first. We feel by adopting this model, we are better placed to empower the young people we are supporting. Slide eight, please. Plans for the future. Okay, so one project that is close to my heart and the company is make a community payback work long time. And for those that don't understand what community payback is, it's when young people are involved in court orders or being punished by the court, and they have to complete community like projects in the community, like litter picking or clearing up mess. I aim, or we aim, to offer something positive for young people that's close to my heart and that they're going to learn going forward. So one of the plans for the future is to make education be punishment work. Okay, next slide, please. So specialist work, alternative education. As you can see by the stats, there are over 500,000 young people are economically inactive, not in learning or employment, and not looking for work, a number which is rising since COVID-19. Our vision is to offer young people on court orders and community sentences the opportunity to learn key skills linked to horticulture, confidence building, team working, IT skills, maths, English, and skills that they can use late in adulthood. We hope some young people in our projects will grow a love for the outdoors and want a career in horticulture, farming, garden maintenance, or landscaping. Next slide, please. Okay, so yeah, and for me, you know, I think this sums it up. Making memories forever, you know. Making memories is why I do this job, and there's no better way than teaching the next generation the importance of growing your own, and in turn, they will teach their own children. And for me, you know, that's just perfect. You know, I do it myself, my own children, you know, we grow whenever we can, and yeah, it's just fantastic. So that's a little bit about Community Youth Ventures and where we envisage the future. And yeah, we want to bring youth work and horticulture together because we know the benefits of, you know, reducing mental health, anxiety, and learning new skills that they can take into adulthood, which is, you know, why we're here. Right, thank you. Any questions, fire away. Thank you.
Question. Thanks, Carl. That was really, really interesting. I particularly liked your vision for working with people on community payback. I think that's great. Susie, I think your hand is raised, so go ahead with a question.
Oh, sorry, that's from before. Yeah, I'll take it down. No questions. But that was great, Carl. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
We do have one more video. So I know we are experiencing some sound issues with this. And that it has, some of it has been filmed outside. So we have some video content from Buxham, which is a farm in Shovington, in North Bucks. And they've been quite proactive over lockdown in their approach. And so we asked them to create some videos that we could share. So
welcome to Buxham, the 16-acre Shovington Field Farm.
So people ask me often how Buxham came about, and really the starting point was the first arrival of baby beef salads in the supermarkets in the early 2000s, and I thought, well, that's just ridiculous, it's expensive and not very good, and I started experimenting and growing at home, and from that Buxham's expanded into a full range of vegetables. So we're just looking at some of the challenges for basically farmers in general, and one of the biggest ones, particularly with outdoor work, is the climate and the weather. So obviously stormy weather can be quite damaging to crops and to structures. So here we've got polytunnels with hoop doors at the end, which we put them in this design, which isn't actually one manufacturer's design. I've taken different manufacturers' ideas and put them together to make my own system. So these sort of shed the wind because of their shape. The crops inside, we hadn't got this, we're expecting some stormy weather in the next 24 hours, sort of 40 to 60 mile an hour winds. If we haven't put these hoop doors down, the tiny salad crops inside get battered by the wind and bruised, so the leaves become unsaleable. Heavy rainfall can be a problem too, flooding tunnels, flooding outdoor fields. So, you know, you've got to be on the ball and basically all the time prepared to adapt and get yourself out of trouble if things go out of hand, really.
Positives from lockdown was that people discovered the food that's growing on their doorstep, and that maybe one of the best things we can all do is to eat as close to home as possible. doorstep. Don't have food shipped from all the way around the world. All those food miles, all that stuff that doesn't taste of anything because it's the wrong time of year. Eat what you've got.
So we're making fresh pasta here today, which is just simply double oat flour, pinch of salt, bit of oil, and one whole egg and two yolks. And then we'll use the whites that are spare to make meringue another day. And we've got a really seasonal lasagna here, so I made a sheet of lasagna, a whole sheet to fit my dish. And then we've got squash, mushrooms, and spinach in our lasagna. And then we're going to lay the sheet in. And then put our white sauce on the top, and then put another layer.
Brilliant. Tell me about what else you've got going on over here in this jar.
So this is sauerkraut, so basically, very simply, any cabbage. Which you slice thinly, you mix salt with it and massage it till it starts to release some liquid, and then put grated apple and grated beetroot, and then it's in an airtight container with pressure, so there's just a little egg cup in there and a little like a jar lid, so on the top you can see there's liquid and lower down you can see the sauerkraut, and the important thing is to keep the liquid so that the cabbage is covered, and then just release the pressure each day, and after about 4 or 5 days, maybe a week, you can then have your own sauerkraut.
Excellent. And why have you got your greens in a jug over there?
This is just to keep them nice and fresh. So these were picked yesterday and they'll be used over this weekend. If we keep them in some water like that, they'll be at their freshest.
Thank you.
So one of our biggest challenges and one of the hardest things for us to explain as small scale producers is that small scale is fine. Small scale is good for us. So while busy is nice, utterly overwhelmed is not. What we need are a lot more small scale producers. We need a lot more people to be passionate about food, because the bigger you get, the more diluted your product becomes and your service. So one of the things we've done through COVID is we've started Young Growers Club, trying to get some young people to be as passionate as we are about growing things. So we've been growing lemon pips, and we've been growing salad with them, and we've been exploring big seeds and small seeds, and we've been teaching 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 year olds how to take softwood cuttings and hardwood cuttings. We've had to do it in a very safe way, and we've had to do it on a very small scale, but it's something everybody can do at home, and it's something that's going to be really important for the future of the planet.
For more inspiring updates, please visit www.buxom.co.uk. Lovely. So that's the end of all of our videos and presentations. So if there are any questions, Phil, I don't know, in the box for any of the presenters today, or some of the people that are actually in the audience, also sort of a part of different growing projects. So I don't know if there's any questions that can be asked.
Just share a couple of questions from the chat. There was two directed at Carl, along with a few comments of praise for a great project. One of them was about your site, Carl, wondering how big it is. And then the other one was about volunteers and how long they're involved for. And do they go on for formal qualifications? So they're from Hannah and Susie, respectively.
So yeah, the site, it's double the size of a normal site. I'm struggling to measure how big it is in, but a normal site, so it's double the size. So it is fairly big. And there's also a plot next to it, which is another double size plot, which we're hoping to grab onto eventually. With regards to volunteers, at the moment we are looking for volunteers and long-term volunteers as well, because what we want to do is to actually skill the volunteers up to work with young people that are more hard to reach on our program. So it is, you know, if there's buy-in, we can obviously, you know, give a lot to volunteers to get them to where they need to be, to offer, you know, not only voluntary work but to offer something going forward as well. So yeah, very early stages. I can't say much more than that at this present time, but we are in the process of looking for volunteers and making that work.
Did anyone else have any questions for any of the presenters?
Yeah, just a general kind of question to everybody. Have you seen a change in everybody's approach since COVID hit, you know, in terms of getting down the allotment, growing your own, you know, have the discussions changed, particularly since the supermarket shelves were cleared out?
I Yeah, I think for me, what I've sort of seen is that everyone's growing some sort of vegetable and fruits. And I think even when you go to like pick up the kids from school, you know, parents are sharing their veg and fruit because everyone is trying some sort of, you know, growing at home. And I think the benefit for me is that it sort of forced people to find another activity at home. And the great thing is they are spending more time outdoors, growing their own produce and sharing it. And for me, you know, although it was sort of forced upon us, it is people are staying with it. And for me, I think that's a positive.
Justin, you're on mute. So
may I answer that question in our aspect as well? Is that all right?
Go for it.
Yeah. So in our case, it's getting the volunteers to allotment under COVID-19 restrictions is, of course, is pretty hard. So in that case, we are asking people to come with is one or two people, and they are coming and dropping the stuff and digging the small area and go. Most of the time, we are the people who do in our community, and we grow and give it to people. So by giving the, on top of this, we are thinking about for next year is a patio gardening. So we are planning to initiate a patio garden concept in our local areas. So we are working on it, and patio gardening, what can you do? And in terms of, we can provide some samples, then they can put into their patio and go on. So in the spring coming, and we are thinking about especially in the springtime, it's a flower and the herbs brought in a patio and your windowsill. So that's the thing we are planning in next year.
That's a great idea. Love it.
I was just going to say there's been a lot more networking, obviously, through COVID. So through the work Hannah's been doing with the food partnership and Becca's been doing, it's been easier if you have a small project to attract funders, to get connected, to get networked. So I think in that respect, things have grown quicker and have been, well, it seems like we were approached by the council, they wanted to fund us. I think that's quite unusual. I think that's happened because of the networks that Hannah and Becca have set up. So I think there's a lot of appetite to help small projects grow quite quickly at the moment.
So much.
To meet the need.
Yeah. It makes
my life worthwhile when people say things.
it's
Yeah, can I say something? I think we found it quite hard because our community allotment has mental health recovery clients coming to the community plot. And although it's huge, it's a full plot, 250 square metres, and you can easily spread out. We felt just to look as if we're complying, we should have only one community gardener to one volunteer, like me and Richard and two others, just so we are seen to be complying, which is difficult for our growers because the very fact they've got mental health issues is when they really need to come to the allotment and want to come. And we are having to schedule them, you know, you come at 9:30, you come at 10:30, you come at 11:30. And that really doesn't sit well with their rather chaotic approach to life. So yes, it has been hard.
Just wanted to quickly say that there's a big link between obviously the gardening programs and the environment agenda that's going on, and more I'm seeing funders and local councils and whatever trying to bring those two bits together as well. So we're looking at setting up a food forest in Wendover, and I think that would have been really like not on the agenda at all before all of this, before COVID, before what's happening next year with the COP. With the environmental COP. So I think there's loads of opportunities at the moment. If you've got a good idea, you know, again, we were offered the land by the council. It wasn't us trying to find the land necessarily. So there are lots of opportunities for community growing out there.
I was going to say, I think it's been really exciting from feedback's point of view, because we've been involved with quite a few of the seed projects this year. So it's been really nice to sort of see the sort of timely start of those projects, and because of COVID and sort of the food redistribution and the food poverty as well, how we've been involved with quite a lot that's been happening in Bucks. So it's been really nice to see that development, and with the sort of the food partnership sort of being born, if you like, this year, I think it's a really timely sort of approach to looking at those things that are environmental, educational, you know, and when it comes to people's own physical and mental health, how we can marry those all up together and support so many different streams as well, from sort of mental health to the food banks, you know, to a whole range of different organisations that maybe weren't working together in the past, but definitely this year have been able to sort of come together and work in partnership, which has been really good to see.
Shall we just talk about the AQA that we've been thinking about? I'm looking at doing a gardening course for Alfriston School, which are special needs girls, but they're only girls at this school. And Becca asked if we would go in, Richard and I, and do a 12-week gardening course with the girls and try and develop an AQA qualification for them, which is very basic and simple, but at least the girls can feel they've got a piece of paper that they've achieved.
Yeah. I was going to say, it's something that actually this year feedback have taken on, so we've actually become an AQA centre. So AQA is a sort of a unit approach to like accreditation for people of all walks of life, but particularly those that are going to respond to more sort of non-formal approaches and more vocational courses. So feedback have become a centre this year, and we've already, I think, published on the AQA website, got some of our food waste unit, so it's been really good to see, and that obviously can be used by anyone who's affiliated with the AQA. So everything from, you know, sort of the composting to the food waste reduction through then to community gardening. And it's something that with the opportunity we've got at Alfriston School is to look at how we can make a blueprint to involve schools through the AQA accreditation with sort of building up their allotments in their school or their school gardens and encouraging young people to explore and grow food. So yeah, that's been a really good outcome from this year.
So I guess... follow on from that. Thank you for mentioning that, Sheila. I think, Carl, you were mentioning something about doing AQAs for the people you're working with. Have you got anything to add to that?
Oh, is that me? Is that directed to me?
Yeah.
Yeah. What can I add to it? We will be, you know, doing qualifications, AQAs with young people, designed specifically around horticulture, but also independent living skills. So skills that they're going to take into adulthood and support them in that sort of development. So it's not just a one-prong approach, the AQA, just focusing on growing, but it's also the general package that young people need to grow to have better lives. So it's not just AQAs, we will be tapping into local colleges, also apprenticeships, looking at, you know, different avenues to see what's out there. There isn't a lot at the moment due to COVID times, but, you know, if we can attach ourselves to certain colleges in our local area, then I think going forward, that would be a nice way to actually build that link.
Yeah, thank you.
Cheers.
Okay, is that everything for sort of questions? It's been really good to have you all here joining us for this session. So thank you for spending your Sunday morning with us. If we are seeing you again today, then we are running, I think it's three more events that we've got coming up this afternoon and this evening. So take care. Have a lovely afternoon. If we see you again, see you shortly, and enjoy the garden. And any questions, then do get back in touch with us.